This is Max Blumenthal from the Gray Zone, catching up to Ro Khanna, Congressman Ro Khanna, who we have a lot to say about this evening. Catching up to him on the street, asking him what he thinks of the Russia sanctions. This clip was pulled off of a tiny little YouTube channel called Enema of the State. So shout out to them for clipping this content, and you'll see their brief intro on it before the video starts. But this is quite something. So Ro Khanna, by the way, I mean, most of you guys know who he is, one of the so-called progressives in the House. He was a co-chair of the Bernie Sanders 2020 campaign, one of the worst offenders in terms of just folding on the Build Back Better negotiation. Right before they folded and voted through the bipartisan infrastructure deal, which they promised not to unless Build Back Better passed with it. They asked Ro Khanna, how could you do this? Like, I think Cenk Uygur even asked him this question. Like, how could you pass one without the other when your whole point all along was that in order to maintain leverage, you had to promise and stick to your guns and hold the line on not passing one without the other? And his answer was, well, if we stick to that, we won't get anything through. Which is fucking moronic. Like, yes, that's the whole point. That's what your leverage means. That's what negotiation means, is that you have to be willing to get up and walk away. Otherwise, you're not actually negotiating, moron. You know, so anyway, that's Ro Khanna. Just a brief intro. All right. So now let's watch this and just think, this is the progressive. This is the progressive hope in the Congress, right? This is one of the good Democrats here, sounding exactly like every other Democrat and quite a few neocon Republicans as well.
And I was just wondering what you thought of the Russian oil ban.
I support the ban on oil.
So do you think that working class Americans should pay more to escalate the cost against Russia?
No, I think we need to ban the oil from Russia, and we need to reduce gas prices in this country. And the way we reduce gas prices is to say to the big oil companies, you can't be making billions of profits while gouging people at the pump.
I mean, prices are already
going... easy to just bring down gas prices. Yeah. We just have to tell the oil companies, listen, you're not being fair here. You're gouging people.
We didn't do that before, but we're going to do it now.
I mean, you could have cheap insulin that way too. Hey, come on.
Sure.
What are you charging so much?
Well,
I mean, I could probably get a free bacon and egg sandwich tomorrow morning at the deli if I try that tomorrow. I mean, he says, okay, that's $3.50. I say, hey, come on. What do you mean $3.50? Come on. Come on. You could sell this to me for a dollar. What are you being so greedy for?
Right? I know, so what that's these his ingredients idea, to
bring,
cost.
Bring down oil. You're right. That's his plan. We have to say, but I mean, this is perfectly consistent.
Well, it's politician speak.
Well, but this is perfectly consistent with him and Jayapal and AOC and all of them. They all tweet as to what we should do. Mm-hmm. They all tweet as to what these companies should do, what oil companies should do, what drug companies should do. We have to tell them, you can't gouge the American people at the pump. Mm-hmm. So that's how it works. That's why we elect you, to tell them that they shouldn't charge so much money. That's literally what he says here.
Can't be making billions of profits while gouging people at the pump.
I mean, prices are already going up massively because of the sanctions, inflation's going up, and that's all to fight Russia. I mean, that's the message Biden and his people are sending. Don't you think? I mean, do you think Americans, what skin in the game do Americans have for Ukraine?
Americans have the skin in the game to stand up for freedom, to stand up for human rights. We've always done that as a nation. And we want to make sure that we stand up for Europe and NATO. And we stand up to bullies. I mean, people see on television Putin killing children, killing mothers. I mean, it's horrific. And we as an American, we are the greatest nation in the world. We've always... stood up for freedom, we stand up for human rights.
So raising inflation,
we're the greatest nation in the world. We always stand up for freedom.
That's just
and
amazing.
Human rights.
Like, does Ro Khanna believe that? Or is that, you know, I mean, it's the boilerplate shit that you're supposed to say as a member of the government. Does he actually believe that?
Well, the thing is,
for years we've been supporting a fucking genocide in Yemen. Like, what is he talking about?
he put out a tweet in 2018 criticizing us, meaning the U.S. government, for lending support to the Azov Battalion, saying that they're a far right group. I mean, that was just that was 3 years ago. So no, this guy, I mean, he's the worst of them. He's the worst of the progressive. I mean, just a complete full of shit asshole. I mean, this, tell me what the difference is between that and something that Hillary Clinton would say, John McCain would say, you know, Marco Rubio would say.
We've always stood up for freedom.
Right. I mean, it's the exact same thing. It's the exact same thing. This is a co-chair of the Bernie campaign.
Oil prices for freedom.
I don't think that's connected. I think the reason that people are paying $5 at the pump and $6 at the pump is because these big oil companies are profiting billions of dollars. Why is it that they're putting the billions of dollars, because the price of oil is going up? Why do they put that in with their stockholders with stock buybacks? Make sure that they are being taxed if they're fleecing the American public, and lower the gas prices. That's what we need to do.
Right, and you kind of ran on an anti-war peace platform. You're part of the Progressive Caucus. Do you support all the foreign fighters and weapons being sent into Ukraine, sending them aircraft, Stinger missiles, calling for an insurgency?
I was opposed to the war in Iraq, because that was an unjust war. I had supported the strike in Afghanistan because those were terrorists, and I was opposed then to the long years in Afghanistan. But I think that this is a just war that the Ukrainians
are shipping more weapons and escalating.
Well, we're making sure that they are armed to be able to fight that, and the Congress is going to pass $10 billion, and I support them, their ability to stand for self-determination.
All right. Bravo, Ro Khanna. Now, before we talk about some of the merits of those statements, I just want to say, you know, Ro Khanna did not appreciate Max Blumenthal doing that to him. And so he put up a tweet later that day, which he has since deleted because he knows how bad a look this is. But kudos to Aaron Mate for having the wherewithal to screenshot it before he deleted it. So now we could take a look.
He saw the delete coming.
Yeah. And so, right. Yeah. He got out in front of it. I mean, look, tell me this is not a James Carville, Paul Begala, you know, just, you know, sentiment here. So here's Ro Khanna. The far left, just first of all, right there, we didn't elect these fucking people to be like smearing us as the far left. Like the quote unquote far left is who put you there, you fucking piece of shit. Okay. The far left's refusal to condemn the immoral and illegal Putin invasion is appalling. It is a nihilistic relativism, which that's a bit of a mind fuck there too. Nihilistic relativism. I don't even know how you even compute that.
I mean, I get where he's going with that. But okay. Yeah.
I stand by my words in this exchange and reject Max Blumenthal and RT talking points where he's a contributor. So then he does the McCarthyite thing against him, right? I have a human rights progressive approach to FP. All right. And so since he realized that was a really terrible look, especially if he wants to run for president or something, you know, to challenge Biden, which there's certain rumblings that he might want to be doing that. Yeah, apparently. I mean, I would say he has absolutely no chance in the world, but, you know.
No. Zero.
Yeah, absolutely zero.
Literally, I place this odds at zero.
But that's what he says there. That's his response to this whole, you know, this whole exchange. Now, I would just like to know, because, you know, there's people who say, I mean, these are the people who I don't understand. Like, it's people like Ro Khanna. I don't understand people saying, well, we don't want to commit U.S. troops because that would start World War III. We don't want to institute a no-fly zone because that would start World War III. But we're going to ship in, you know, virtually unlimited quantities of weapons for the Ukrainian army to fight the Russians. How do they expect, like, what is the game plan there? Is the game plan there just to prolong this fighting until there's a negotiation and get their defense contractor donors paid? Or is it to actually escalate to a point where it's going to turn into World War III? Like, if you keep fueling this fighting, eventually it is going to escalate into something that is out of control, that the United States and NATO will eventually have to directly intervene in a way where we will call it World War III. Like, I don't understand. I don't understand this middle ground strategy that we are pursuing, which is funding the Ukrainian army, but not committing troops ourselves. It seems like you either want to beat the Russians or you don't. If you want to beat them, you're probably going to have to beat them in a world war. If you want the fighting to stop, you have to tell Zelensky to drop the Rambo Act and start negotiating. Like, those to me are the two positions that make some sort of coherent sense. I'm obviously vehemently against the former, but at least I understand that. Like, people who are saying, okay, no fly zone, this either works or it doesn't. If it works, great. If not, I guess we're going to war. That at least makes some degree of sense. This, where we're just going to keep funding the Ukrainian army and just like perpetuate this violence in the hopes of what? I mean, we heard certain people saying that, you know, Afghanistan and Syria are a model. What, we're going to bog the Russians down for 10 years? So you want this to go on for 10 years, basically. Or you want it to just escalate, sort of organically, if you will. From a Ukraine-Russia fight into something that eventually implicates us anyway. Because that seems to be the strategy that we are pursuing. I think it's completely psychotic and actually the most nihilistic of all. Like, this, what we're doing right now seems more nihilistic than anything, because we're not doing anything to change the dynamic. Nothing. We're just letting it go. All these people stand with Ukraine. Viva Ukraine. Long live Ukraine. Ship weapons into Ukraine. They're the ones who want the violence to continue. The people like, you know, me, I won't speak for you, who say, no, we need a ceasefire and negotiation. I'm saying that because I want the violence to stop. I want it to stop. I want the kill. I want the wholesale slaughter of the Ukrainian people to stop. And unfortunately, because of the world we live in, I think the only way to stop it is to negotiate. And given the Kremlin's three main terms there, no NATO EU, we want Crimea, and we want the separatist regions declared independent. I think those are terms that any sane leader with any real concern for the well-being of himself and his people and the international community, which does not want to get dragged into a world war, which could potentially result in a nuclear exchange. I think the only responsible thing to do is to sign on the dotted line under those three terms.
I think their overall strategy is, as we discussed last time, I think they're trying to put so much pressure on the oligarchs that they take Putin out, like, you know, by, you know, taking away their yachts and their vacation homes and that kind of thing. I think that's part of what they're thinking. I think they're seeing it somewhat as an opportunity to take a rival off the board by destroying their economy for, you know, decades to come. So in that sense, they probably do want it prolonged, because the longer this goes on, the more difficult it's going to be for the Russian economy to recover from this. In terms of the actual fighting in Ukraine, Hillary said the soft part out loud by making those comparisons.
Yes, well, we had certain complications in Afghanistan, but
complications like Al-Qaeda. But she felt that was a grand old strategy. And I think a lot of them probably do. Not that this going on for 10 years is not feasible. Like, that's not feasible. From what I can see, if I had to guess, Russia is going to take Kiev in the next week. Yeah, I'd say in the next week, Russia's probably going to take Kiev. week and a half.
Look, in those terms that they outlined, they didn't even want, they're not even going to keep the territories they've already conquered, according to those terms, if those are the terms, you know. So I mean, to me, it just seems totally insane not to take that and stop this violence. I mean, it's,
well,
just
they're hoping, and this is something I think they're very wrong about, Putin is, this is not about Ukraine. This is about establishing a second power base, an alternative to the West. I think ultimately he'd like to see this play out to the point that the dollar's status as a reserve currency is seriously weakened. Mm-hmm. I think he's also demonstrating how much power his country and also his sphere of influence has over resources that the world needs. Wheat, copper, nickel prices shot up 250%. He's flexing his muscles. He doesn't, given that he's playing, I think, for much bigger stakes than Ukraine, he has no incentive to back down. He's probably been nursing this for decades. This was his shot to weaken the West and solidify a different coalition of non-Western powers.
Yeah, and that's not failing, by the way. Like, India has backed him. He's partnered with China now to create some alternative to Visa and MasterCard thing. Brazil has not shunned him. You know, they have their own sort of Trump-like president down there, which could be partly why that is. But, like, you know, those are some pretty big countries that I just rattled off there. You know, that's not Uruguay, Bosnia, you know,
And that's if you understand that that's what this is really about, any reports, oh, Putin went crazy, Putin miscalculated. No, he didn't. No, he didn't. This was never about this. Like, yes, he may have thought that the Ukrainians were going to go down easier than they did. But hey, man, you could say that about pretty much anyone who's ever fought a war, that unexpected things came up, that they hoped things would break right and they broke left. Like that happens. But to think he went crazy or he didn't understand what the consequence of this could be, you're really not looking at the big picture. He saw that the West was as weak as it's going to be. They had the West had runaway inflation coming out of COVID. There was never going to be a time when a move like this had a better chance of succeeding, where the West was in a weaker position to withstand the economic consequences of this kind of a conflict. I mean, look, they were talking about destroying the Russian economy. What about this economy? Right, what are we going to do with $7 a gallon gas? Like, America has already shown serious signs of social instability over the last decade, at least. How unstable do you think things will get with $7 a gallon gas, where people can't fucking drive their cars and heat their homes?
Yeah,
what do you think's going to happen?
What
if it goes higher than that?
Well, it very well could. And
yeah, it could.
That's here. We're not even talking about Europe, what the consequence of that. I mean, Germany already said, look, we still have to buy the Russian oil. We're sorry. 80% of our oil comes from there.
We can't turn the lights off in Germany. That's assuming that the Russians don't turn around. I said this from the beginning, man. They could go, Ivan, turn wheel. No more gas coming to down the Nord Stream 1. This is something else I have been saying for fucking years to these liberals who want to get tough on Russia, You're talking about a people that burned their own capital so that Napoleon's soldiers wouldn't have anywhere to sleep. You're not taking these people down with sanctions, man. I'm sorry. Like, if there are any people on Earth who would turn around and shut off the gas and take the economic consequences in order to destroy the enemy, that would be a classic Russian move. Classic. That would be burning Moscow so that Napoleon's soldiers don't have anywhere to sleep.
Right. Yeah, no, you know, it's amazing. I mean, it's just one of the, and look, I mean, I meant to make this point in the first segment. I think it's a good point to sort of tie everything together as we get close to wrapping here. The only voices of sanity that I'm hearing on this issue are coming from leftists who have gotten deplatformed. Lee Camp.
Yes.
I don't know if I mentioned Lee Camp earlier, but Lee Camp is one of them. Lee Camp, Chris Hedges, Abby Martin, you know, they're all gone. And then the only other voices of sanity are coming from the right, and sometimes the very far right.
Dude, you know, there's another example of what I keep saying. I don't know what right and left mean anymore. You know, Tucker Carlson, because YouTube feeds me the videos, like I don't seek him out, but they threw up his most recent video about the oil. And find me somebody in the mainstream left media who's sitting there and framing it this way. Like, what's in it for Americans? Why should Americans be paying these gas prices and calling Colbert and that cohort of rich people talking about how great this is? Show me something like that on MSNBC where they're framing it in that way. Show me. Well, and this is what's crazy. What Tucker Carlson is saying there, he sounds like a fucking classic leftist. These are classic left kinds of arguments.
Okay, yeah.
Against war, pointing out the military-industrial complex, talking about how much money oil companies are making, talking about how the common people are going to suffer while the wealthy are just going to skate through. This is all left, classic left points in a situation like this. But what is called the left today, their mainstream voices, quote unquote, have nothing to say on that level. They don't speak to that at all. They are the elites who are not going to feel it, who can afford $7 a gallon gas, who can weather that.
Yeah. And even the Bernie left has been mostly, you know, towing the party line here. Bernie himself has been mostly towing the party line here. I haven't heard him say anything worth repeating about this. Tucker Carlson.
I think this is a good time. All right, in Taibbi's article, he pulls out a quote from Cornel West, and as always, Cornel West hits the nail on the head. Everybody knows if Russia had troops in Mexico or Canada, there would be invasions tomorrow. Biden sends the Secretary of State telling Russia, "You have no right to have a sphere of influence." After the Monroe Doctrine, after the overthrowing of democratic regimes in Latin America for the last 100 some years, come on, America. Do you think people are stupid? What kind of hypocrisy can anybody stand? Now, that doesn't mean that Putin is not still a gangster. Of course he is. But so were the folk promoting the Monroe Doctrine that had the U.S. sphere of influence for decade after decade after decade after decade. And anybody critical of you, you would demonize. Yet here you are, right at the door of Russia, and can't see yourself in the mirror. That's spiritual decay right there, brother. It really is. That says it all.
Yeah, and they would say that he's engaging in whataboutism, which is not a real word. Whataboutism is a made-up term that liberals came up with to excuse their own bullshit when they get called on.
Yes.
That's
yes.
what aboutism is.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
That's all that is. Yes. And that's probably what Ro Khanna would call, what did he call it? You know, nihilistic relativism or relativist nihilism. Yeah. Saying, well, if one thing is okay, then everything's okay and we should just not do anything about it. But that's not what we're saying. That's not what we're saying. What we're saying is we live in a world of big fish and little fish, and the United States is a big fish that does not tolerate certain things from the little fish swimming around it, and neither does Russia. And so the big point here is not that what Putin's doing is okay, and we're not justifying what Putin's doing by simply saying, well, what about, what the United States has done. What we're saying is that the world cannot possibly work in the way that you want it to work. That's not doable. Like, if the international community came down as hard on the United States for any one of its several imperialist offenses, as hard as we want the international community to come down on Russia right now, then we wouldn't have a country either. We would not exist in our current form either. Nothing about the world would function the way it does now. And so for you to advocate for a third world war over this, what you have to understand is that if you are saying this is worth World War III, which eventually, I mean, eventually that's going to be what it comes to if you actually want to beat Russia. You're not just going to send enough Molotov cocktails to grandma in Ukraine to beat Russia. It's going to take the whole world to beat Russia, hence World War III. Right. If you think this is worth World War III, then what you have to understand is that
launch nukes if you do that.
Well, right. Well, yes. But what I'm saying is, if this is worth a third world war, right? If geopolitics worked in such a way that this Russia-Ukraine conflict was worth fighting World War III over, then because of our history of different offenses here and there all around the world, given a world in which other countries react the way we want to react to Russia now, we'd be on World War VI, VII, or VIII right now. Like, there'd have already been three, four, or five additional world wars right now. There might not even be a human race left. The Earth might have been thrown off its orbit by the number of nuclear bombs that would have gone off between Japan 1945 and now. If the world worked that way, the world doesn't work that way. That's why, yes, he's a gangster. Yes, but you know what? I mean, we made the Sopranos analogy. Some countries are made, some countries are not made. Goodfellas, right, Ray Liotta? When you're a made guy, you can fuck with anybody. They can't touch you. Well, you know, Saddam wasn't that guy. Saddam was Henry Hill. Vladimir Putin's not Henry Hill. Vladimir Putin's a made guy. He's made because he has the fucking button that makes the whole world go kaboom. And you cannot treat a power that way, the way you treat Gaddafi, Saddam, you know, I mean, you just cannot do it. You just cannot do it. Right. And to advocate to treat him that way, it's just, it's suicide. It's just insane suicide.